right, please turn with me to Genesis chapter 12. Book of Bereshit, the covenant. Back to the beginning. I'm going to do the Torah portion today, Lech Lecha, and then we will split the service for the second half, which I believe will actually be related. All right, so let's begin. Now the Lord had said to Abram, "Get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in all you and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram departed as Yahweh had spoken to him, and Lot went with him. Who is Lot? His nephew, right? And Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Haran. So then Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people whom they had acquired in Haran, and they departed to go to the land of Canaan. So they came to the land of Canaan. So I want to stop right here for just a second and just let you know that Abram, first of all, is a goy. He's a Gentile. He's not a Hebrew by any stretch of the imagination. He's literally a Gentile. And this is an interesting thing to bring up if you ever talk to someone that is Jewish, or you have a friend that's Jewish, is to remind them, even though they know this, it's so far from their memory of their childhood in school that it almost shocks their system to remind them that their very ancestor that started all of the tribes of Israel was a Gentile from the very beginning. God called out to his people in the far corners of the earth, and began to bring out of the people a new people. And it starts with Abram. But everybody knows the story about Abram and his name changing to Abraham, right? We all know that. But everybody ever wonder why? What is the purpose and point behind God changing someone's name? How many know that in Hebrew, most of you, if you sit under my teaching, you know this, that Hebrew is an incredibly deep language. Every single word has a meaning, every character, every letter has a meaning, and every letter is a number. And so built in, this is where originally, I think it was back in the 80s, that the Bible code became very popular. This is the concept. It used numbers and letters because Hebrew is that real. There's a lot built into that matrix. Matter of fact, even the sages, the ancient rabbis, will say that every event that's ever happened since the creation of the universe can be found in the first five books of Moses in that matrix, that in the actual Hebrew letter sequences, every act that every human has ever done and every event that's happened actually was already written before time began. And whether that's true or not, I don't know, but I believe my God is big enough and that's smart enough to do that. And so it's an interesting thought. But I like to look at the Hebrew and look at the letters and look at the names of people, because when God says that he is going to change someone's name, this is not because he just thinks, you know, this would be kind of neat to add to the Bible so that when Americans actually read it, they'll just think it's cool. No, in God's universe, names mean things. Names have purpose. Names have mission. There's not a person alive today that before you were born, your mother and your father were thinking hard about what to name you. When moms are pregnant, it's one of the very first things that happens is they start, especially if they find out that it's a boy or a girl, they want to start looking for a name. Matter of fact, most parents will start looking for a name before they even know if it's a boy or a girl. And then they argue with their spouse for months on that topic. And one of the things that is most popular, especially today when looking at names, is they will look up the name, and amazingly, people rarely choose names without looking at the meaning. Isn't that strange? How many of you would agree with me that if you had someone in your high school that was named so-and-so, and you could not stand that woman for nothing, you're not going to name your firstborn daughter that name. We are the weirdest people in the world. Because what on earth does that name have anything to do with disqualifying it for your children just because you don't like the person? You follow me? Is that not illogical? Am I the only one that thinks that is strange? I would have a very difficult time naming, my child Mariah, even though it's a beautiful name. Why? It has tremendous meaning. Because my mom has a dog named Mariah. And it's a German giant, 130-pound German shepherd. So it would be very difficult for me to name a child Mariah when our family pet has 130 pounds of Mariah. But that makes no sense because Mariah is a beautiful name. We should not rule it out because of that. I'm here to tell you I believe that God has purpose and meaning behind names. So here's a couple thoughts. I got to remember I only got 30 minutes. So, all right, here we go. Abram, Aleph, Beit, Resh, and Mem. And Mem, okay? In the Paleo Hebrew, this is what it means. Aleph is the ox or the strength of the leader. Beit is house. Resh is the head of. And Mem is like a water, okay? Or it's specifically like the waters of Noah's flood. It's called the former rain, the waters of chaos. Although in English, chaos, we think of disorder. But in God's realm of thinking, chaos is what washes away things and brings new life. So purposeful chaos, if that, organized chaos. And so Abram means the strength of the house is the head of the waters. That's what it means. So the strength of the house is the head of the waters. I want you to keep an eye on this as we kind of move through here. Because what happened is Yahweh simply squeezed out a couple things and added the letter He. And in the middle there is the actual Paleo-Hebrew pictograph form of what the letter He used to look like. And it was a man jumping up and down or praising the Lord. And it meant behold or revelation. And so God changed Abram's name to Abraham, which changed the meaning of the name from the strength of the house is the head of the waters to the strength of the house is the head of open revelation of the waters. So what happened when Abram's name was changed and his wife's name was changed? What physically happened that came from them? A new baby, right? Something came through the waters. There was the waters of chaos. There was open revelation of the water. So it wasn't closed waters any longer. There was open revelation. Revelation for what? Before Abram's name was changed, he had no purpose, no mission, and no calling. But when God changed his name, there was a change in his mission and his purpose and his calling. Sarai, as some would say, Shin Resh Yod. It's the all-consuming fire is the head of the right-hand power of God. Sheen is teeth or consuming fire, fire of God. Again, Resh is the head, and Yod is the right-hand strength, the power of God. So Sarah is the all-consuming fire, is the head of the right-hand power of God. But when her name was changed, unbelievably, a hay was added as well. And so it went the all-consuming fire is the head of revelation. That's what got changed, is the umbilical cord of God was opened up because it was revealed. The all-consuming fire is the head that is revealed. The head that would come from Abraham and Sarah, the progeny or the seed, would be revealed through the opening of the womb, if you will. So Sarah and Abram's name, literally their entire purpose and journey changed when God changed their name. Let's dig a little bit deeper. Let's skip through this for just a second, and let's get to this. So let's get back to this here. Back to the Scriptures, and keep reading. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your descendants, verse 7, I will give this land. And there he built an altar to the Lord who appeared to them. Whoops, I skipped all kinds of stuff. Verse 4. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Then Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people whom they had acquired in Haran, and they departed to go to the land of Canaan. So they came to the land of Canaan. Abram passed through the land to the place of Shechem, as far as the terebinth tree of Moreh, and the Canaanites were then in the land. And so this is really important. As I came across this scripture, the Father said, stop research. And so whenever he highlights something in scripture, it sometimes frustrates me because I just like want to read the Bible for once, just once, just read the Torah portion without stopping. I don't think I've ever read one chapter without having to stop and go on a rabbit trail. Has that ever happened to you, Pastor? Yes. It's very frustrating, but it's a great way to learn. And so I started going through and researching Moreh a little bit, and I put it in a PowerPoint because it's easier to see. And I want you to see this. Moreh, it is the Strong's number 4176, and we're going to break it down for you a little bit. In the Strong's, what it means is teacher. In the literal, it's an oak tree at Shechem, like we're reading, where Abram stopped when he first entered Canaan, close to the mountains of Ebal and Gerizim, which are just huge points in biblical geography of huge things that happened from Gideon to Abram to Moses himself. This is a really, to Joshua, Aaron, the altar there. This is a very big stuff that's happening at this place. So we want to get into this a little bit and discover what this is all about. The tree of Moreh. What is the tree of Moreh? Well, first of all, you need to know that in ancient Israel, it's very much like it is today from the perspective of every once in a while, you'll come across this giant 2,000, 3,000-year-old tree. You'll come across a very old tree, and they will get very large. And I've been at one at Timnah, and I believe it was at Timnah. But in any case, huge tree, and they're very elaborate, these trees, when they get that old. And just like you see in movies, the reason why you see in movies that trees, a very significant old tree, is spiritual, and many times a tribe will use that, and they'll park underneath that. And trees in ancient times were connected to spirits. They were connected to the other world. This is why in the Bible it says that you are trees. You are trees. There is a spiritual connection between trees and human beings. And so the ancients believed that these ancient giant trees, even though I know this sounds like they're crazy, that there was something supernatural or significant. But the reality is that this was a great place to meet. It had huge shade, and teachers would meet underneath these trees, and people would make pilgrimage journeys to meet the teachers, to learn, because they didn't have the internet back then. So look at some of these teachers, in Hebrew, rabbi, that would fall, they would have all of this information and knowledge that want to teach people. This was a great place to meet. And so people would come, they would meet with the teacher would teach them about this, that, and the other. This is what this is. This was the oak of Moreh, or the oak of the teachers, the oak of the teacher. All right, that's going to be important here in just a minute. So 4175, let's go back here, 4176, you see how it says the same as 4175. So if you look in your Strong's Concordance, 4176 is Moreh, but it says it's the same as 4175. So let's go to 4175 and find out what that word is. It's the same word. 4175 and 76 are both Moreh, but look at the difference. It can also mean rain, the former rain, or a teacher. And this gets so cool as we go through here, because I love Hebrew because it's beyond the Greco-Roman American English that is just so flat. And these words just wrap all kinds of concepts so that you will really know what a teacher is. Because today, when I say teacher, you think of this. This is what you think of, because all of us grew up inside of schools where you have professors that are teaching. Okay? But in ancient Israel, the concept of teacher is far deeper than just someone that's giving you information. And right away, we're starting to get a little bit of an idea of what a teacher is connected to. Amazingly, a teacher is connected to the former rains. Now, for those of you that are not familiar with the agricultural cycles that are found in the country of Israel, there are two rains that happen in Israel, the former rain and the latter rain. The former rain comes in the fall during the Feast of Sukkot, normally around end of September, October, and goes all the way through the month of the fall rains happen in the fall. That's called the former rains, and that's the planting season. And so although it's harvest, they're also planting. As soon as the harvest is over, they're re-tilling the ground and replanting, trying to beat the former rain. The seed goes in the ground, and then the former rains come in the fall. The former rains are very hard. They're very strong. Then comes the latter rain. The latter rain is the second season of the year of rain, which happens in the springtime. Now, I know from American mindset, that's backwards. We would say the former rain should be in the spring, and the latter rain should be in the fall. But the biblical cycle of agriculture in the scriptures starts in the fall. So from their perspective, there's multiple year cycles. You have the agricultural year, which starts in the fall and goes fall to fall. So the seed goes in the fall. Some of it gets reaped in the spring. That's where your first fruits and barley come from. Some of it gets reaped in the middle of the summer. That's in Shavuot. That's where the wheat harvest happens. And the rest of it gets harvested back in the fall again, right before Sukkot. And so it's important for you to see that a teacher is connected to the early or the former rain. Make sense? Okay. Inside of the word more, I noticed something that was very interesting. Is the word yarah, okay? A yarah is a yod, resh, and hey. That's inside the red box there. And so more, I don't know if I gave the Paleo Hebrew for more, but more would be the waters that connect the head of Revelation. That's what that means. The waters, vav is a nail that connects, the head is resh, and to reveal a revelation. So the waters that connect are the waters of the nail is the head of Revelation. So more is, if you are believing Yeshua, you should be thinking Yeshua, right? You should be instantly thinking Jesus Christ the Messiah, because He is the waters of the nail that is the head of Revelation, right? And amazingly, it means teacher. So the greatest teacher is the one who is the one who brings water that connects the head that reveals. And so Yahrah, if you go look up Yahrah, and I got all this for you so you can write it down, Strong's 3384, and I just copied and pasted so you know I'm not making it up. Properly to flow as water. This is what the word Yahrah means, which is the root word for marae. It means to flow as water, to rain, to lay or throw, especially an arrow, to shoot an arrow, figuratively, to point out, as if by aiming a finger, to teach, an archer, to cast, direct, inform, instruct, lay, show, shoot, teach, through. Literally, it means to throw water. It means to throw water. So Yahrah means to is the idea of aiming an arrow. Can anybody tell me in the scriptures what an aiming an arrow makes you think of? Any other scriptures that you think of when you hear of aiming an arrow, or any concepts? What are arrows? Children. Thank you. And so Yahweh says that your children are like arrows, and you're supposed to take them and you're supposed to pull them back and shoot them. Where? Where would you shoot an arrow? At the enemy, which is the bullseye. So isn't it interesting? Well, let me come back to that for a second. No, I better not, because I'll forget. I only got 4 minutes left. It's just not possible, folks. Strap in for a long night. So anyway, so when the Bible says that we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, did you know that the word there in the Hebrew means to miss the mark? That's what sin is. It's connected to this, yara. Yara is to pull back and aim and shoot an arrow at a target. So when you sin, it simply means that you missed your target. Now, we've already established that children are arrows. And so you pull them back, and we already established that we want to use them to aim at the enemy as our target, right? So let this sink in, although I have no time to go here. But if you miss the mark, have you not sinned before your Lord God? So the greatest thing that we can ever do is raise up a generation that will aim themselves at the heart of the enemy. It is the first and greatest commandment of all time. You might say, oh, Jim, you must not know the Torah because it says to love the Lord God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Read your Bible from the front of the book when it says be fruitful and multiply. Because that is the first commandment given to Adam and Eve with the intention of them only eating from the tree of life. Let's continue. Look at this. Yara, if we change out just the first letter, mem, and put a tav there, you get the word Torah. The very center and the root of Torah is yara. And what does tav mean in Paleo Hebrew but covenant? So yara is the arrows or the shooting of the instructions, the covenant. It's the covenant of archery. It's the covenant of the shooting. It's the covenant of the throwing of the waters. Now, I sat down in my office just not too long ago, and they were praying over me before the service, and I was asking myself, throwing waters, this just doesn't make any sense. You're going to be really bummed that you sat in the front row. No, I'm just kidding. Y'all were holding your breath on that. But no, seriously, if I take water and put it in the cup of my hand and I throw water, it doesn't do a whole lot of damage. It just doesn't make any sense that I can throw water. Enemy, come on. Woo, he's really scared. I'll throw water at you. As he's got all of his fiery arrows pointed at me. And so as I was thinking through this and I was meditating as they were praying over me, I just was just really in deep meditation. And the Father opened my eyes that I was looking from my perspective of this example I just gave you of putting water in my hand and throwing water. When the Bible clearly says that the enemy is firing fiery arrows. They're arrows of fire. So what do you think God's arrows are made of? Water. It's not glass of water. It's not a bucket of water. It's not even a fire hose. The enemy, this is the supernatural realm. I'm thinking from the natural realm. You can't have an arrow of water. But somehow I believed you can have an arrow of fire. So Yahweh says, Jim, the Torah and Moreh and Yara, which is all connected to the same word, throwing water is what my Torah does. My Torah is your arrow instruction for you to take the water of the word and fire it into the heart of the enemy and put him out. It is only when you know the water of the word that you can use it as an arrow and fire it into the darts of the enemy and put out every enemy dart that comes firing at you. And it brings up so much. If you go back to that slide, it doesn't like to let me do that when I'm done. But it brings up so many ideas and concepts of water. It changes the whole idea of water. Because where does water come from? Water comes from the heavens. It comes from the Shemayim, does it not? And so God says that His water is the water of the Word, and the water of the Word is instruction that's designed to be thrown in a specific target in a specific way. And those that are the ones that are throwing are the teachers, those that teach. Now let me expand what you're thinking, because you think that I'm teaching you. I am. And when I say teacher, you're thinking of this, because this is what we've all been taught. But did you know the Bible says that you are teachers? You, if you have the Word of God hidden in your heart, you are a teacher. Maybe not a ecclesia role of a teacher, but you teach nonetheless. So it's imperative that you know the Word of God, that you know the Torah, so that you can rightfully divide it, so that you can fire the right arrow. Because if you fire the wrong arrow at the enemy, you'll miss and you'll get hit by the dart. And what most people do is they don't know the Word of God well enough. I see this over and over and over and over again. They just don't know the Word of God well enough, and the enemy manipulates them. So they're praying, they're prophesying, they're given dreams and visions, but because they don't know the Word of God, the enemy can infiltrate a vision, a dream, a prophetic word, or even their own emotional system, because that's where it all comes in. And the enemy will take the very vision, the very dream, the very Word of God, turn it around and use it for his glory. This is why when someone comes to me and they say, we need to have, you know, more grace and more grace and more grace, this is my response, which I believe is straight from the heavens. God, judge me if I'm wrong. We got enough grace already. We've had 2,000 years of grace. What God's people need is obedience, and they need the knowledge of the Word of God. Because until we learn the Word of God, we will not even have the bow in our hands. We will spout out and throw up all over each other what we think. And this is what's happening in the earth realm today. Many of it is found in the prophetic movement. God is prophesying tremendously through Passion for Truth. We're seeing more visions and more dreams and more prophetic and miracles and healings than I have ever seen in my entire life in this last year. I just did a video blog for myself just so I can remember all of the things that have happened up to this time. And it took an hour and 24 minutes of me talking this fast just to get through them all. But there's a lot of people that God is moving. It's not just a Passion for Truth. It's all over the world. He's speaking. So anyone with the gift of prophecy is hearing the Father move quickly. They're hearing the voices. But if they don't have the guardrails of the instruction manual, the enemy will infiltrate it and add and take away. And they won't even see it. And so the Word, according to the Torah, becomes dead in the earth. It becomes dead. Truly, this is the point of this entire message of what God is doing, this very short message, is that the Torah is designed to be an arrow, the instruction manual to throw water on the enemy. It's not designed to put you in bondage, and it's not designed to drown you. The Word of the living God is designed to refresh you. The Torah is the former rains. What is the former rains? It is the rain that when you see a storm coming, it's that first rain that hits you at 50 miles an hour that blows you over, and the rain comes so hard, it's a gully washer. It breaks up everything. Destroys so many things that shouldn't be there. This is what happens, isn't this not, when you first hear the Word of God and it rubs against you the wrong way? I don't like that. It's not what I believe. My pastor told me this. I learned this. I read this. Haven't you seen Google? He knows everything. That's the former rains hitting you, breaking up, challenging you. It's what the Word of God is designed to do. If the Word of God comes to you and you just feel ooey-gooey all the time, you're not reading the same Word that I'm reading. Because it is not designed to make you feel happy all the time. Is there a designation of it for encouragement? Absolutely. But my word convicts me. It challenges me. It stretches me. Sometimes I don't even want to read it because it's like looking in a mirror and seeing egg all over my face all the time. Who wants to see yourself messed up all the time? That's what the word is designed to do, to show you your sin. Because what is it doing? When you open up the word, the second you open it, water is splashing in your face. And who likes it when someone splashes water in their face? God, stop doing this. Stop. That's kind of fun at first. You get in a pool. We got a pool at our house, and the kids are, you know, get in there, and we start splashing each other. It's always fun until what? Someone gets hurt. Can you get hurt with water? Yeah. When you got six kids and a wife beating up on you and throwing, no, my wife's never a part of it, but the kids love to splash, and they always end up ganging up on me. Next thing you know, I'm burying my hands to cover my eyes. Because the water gets in the eyes and it burns. In the same way, the water of God's Word is designed to get into your eyes. It's designed to burn out that which is not of Him, so that you can see clearly when you're done rubbing your eyes. But most of the time, what we do is we say, stop. Stop splashing me, God. Stop. Stop washing me with Your Word, because it hurts. And I don't like pain. It's the Chinese Christians that like pain. Us American Christians, Lord, if You don't know any better, we like to be coddled and held, and we like to be spoken to gently and told how wonderful we are. You laugh, but you know it's true. American Christianity is sloppy, and we don't really love God when it comes down to it. Why? Because we don't even like water in our face. The very water that's trying to wash us of everything that's on us, so that Yahweh could use us to water someone else. Is this making sense? I believe that Yahweh, in these last days, the drought is over, and God is sending clouds of rain. The former rain is tough. It's difficult. It's a change of lifestyle from a drought, weary, thirsty land to a gully washer of His Word. But the time will come as we are seeding right now. This is the word that Father has for me personally. Seed, seed, seed. Do not worry about growth. Seed, seed, seed. Now is the time to put the seed into the ground. Don't worry about the growth. It's not your problem. Don't worry about what it looks like in the end. It's not your problem. You be an obedient Yara. Teach, seed, seed, seed. And then at some point in the future, when the latter rains come, which is prophesied in the Scriptures to be when the Holy Spirit resurrects His gifts at the end of time, and people will have more dreams and visions, words of prophecy, and Acts chapter 2 will redevelop itself. When the second rain from Acts chapter 2 to the last Acts chapter 2, right before the Messiah comes, when the spiritual part of the Torah is revealed, that it's not just a rain that beats up on the land and destroys everything that is not of Him. That is not the only definition of Torah, is instructing people to do and don't. When the latter rain comes and the Ruach HaKodesh is mixed with the soil of the seed, in one day, the harvest will be ready. In one day, the growth will happen. You'll walk out onto a what looks like a brown field and parking lot, and there'll be nothing. And the next morning, you will walk out, and there'll be green shoots everywhere. So many you can't even count them. These are the days that are coming, says the Lord, is the latter rain of the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, that will mix with the true seed of His Word and the water that you are sending. It is your responsibility to water those around you. Amen? Amen. Would you stand with me for just a second? We're going to close out this half of the message. And Lord willing, next week I will start my series. Yahweh, thank You so much for all that You're doing. We praise you for the water of your word. We thank you that you give us water arrows, Father, to fight the fiery darts of the enemy. We pray, Father, that you would teach us how to hunt. Teach us how to teach. Teach us how to accept the water on our face. Father, we want to be naked before you so that you could clean us, cleanse us, mikvah us, immerse us in your water. We say it, but we don't know the significance of what we say. And so when you begin to answer our prayers of immersing us, we cry out, stop, Lord God, stop. And you say, what you asked me to immerse you. And you say, I'm drowning. So, Father, I pray that you teach us that you are God and we are not, and we need to be careful what we pray, because if we truly want to come closer to you, it will require us to be fully immersed and drown the flesh. Make us more like you, Father. Give us the instructions of how to take our children and shoot them into the hands of the enemy and burn out his ability to even hold a bow. We thank you, Abba, for your word, and we thank you for the guiding power of your water. Amen.